So far we've talked about what partial derivatives are, and we've talked about how to compute them. After all, computing a partial derivative is just like computing a regular derivative, only treating the other variables as constants. Now we're going to talk about what partial derivatives are good for. So, a partial derivative is, just like any other kind of derivative, it's a rate of change. It's just that instead of thinking of a function of one variable, we make it a function of one variable by holding the other variable fixed. So this gives us an approximation for what happens, how much does our function change when we move our x variable from x equals a to some other value of x. Now this formula here should remind you of another formula that we had, namely g of x is g of a plus g prime of a times x minus a. And that's not exact, it's just an approximation. That's an old approximation we had. We use the derivative, g prime of a tells you how fast the function is changing. And if you multiply that by the change in x, you get the change in the function. And it's not just an analogy. If we define the function g of x to be f of xb, then this is literally the same thing. G of x is f of xb, g of a is f of ab, g prime of a is how much g changes as we change x. That's the partial derivative, and x minus a is x minus a. So the partial with respect to x tells us what happens when we change x. The partial with respect to y tells us what happens when we change y. And most of the time, we're interested in what happens when you change both x and y. And if you change both x and y, you get a certain effect of changing x, and you get a certain effect from changing y. And there are some cross terms. The full detail can be a little bit more complicated. But to a very good approximation, you can say that the new value of f at a nearby point is the value you started with, plus the effect of increasing x, or decreasing x as the case may be, plus the effect of changing y. Okay, let's look at our running example. The function f of x is e to the xy squared. And let's look around the point 1, 1. So we already know that the fx is y squared e to the xy squared. And if we evaluate that at 1, 1, we get that fx is e. Likewise, fy is 2e. And so if we wanted to figure out what is the value of f at a nearby point, we'd say, here we are. We know what's happening at 1, and we know how fast it's changing as you move in the x direction. And you know how fast it's changing when it moves in the y direction. So you start off with a value at 1, 1, and you add a good approximation to how much it would change if you went from here to here. And then you add how much it changes as you go from here to here. Now, starting at 1, 1, and going to the right 1.03, and then coming back and going down by 0.1, is not exactly the same thing as going to 1.03.99, but it's very close. The effect of going across 0.03 and down 0.1 is roughly the effect of going across 0.03 plus the effect of going down 0.01. And the effect of going across by 0.03 is the derivative with respect to x times 0.03. And the effect of going down by 0.01 is the derivative with respect to y times minus 0.01. And you add them all together and you get 1.01e, and that's about 2.745. Okay. Now, a notation for this is differentiables. Now, you remember when you had one variable, we had a formula that looked like df is equal to f prime times dx. That was a formula we used for differentials and for giving approximations. But that's if you had just a single variable. Now, what we say is the change in the value of the function is made up of two pieces. one piece that comes because of the change in x, and another piece that comes from the change in y. And you sometimes write it in terms of f sub x, sometimes you write it as partial f partial x, different notations for the exact same thing. Either way, what we're saying is the change of the function is approximately fx times the change in x plus fy times the change in y. Okay. Finally, you might say, well, that's first order. The partial derivatives are telling you the rate of change, but we saw way back when that a linear approximation is only so good. If you want to get more accurate, you need to use second derivatives and third derivatives and fourth derivatives and write down a Taylor series. So here's how the Taylor series works for a function of two variables. You still say, you still expand things in terms of powers, but now you need both powers of x minus a and powers of y minus b. So m and n each go from 0 to infinity. So you have c0, 0 plus c1, 0 times x minus a plus c0, 1 times y minus b plus c1, 1 times x minus a times y minus b. You have a whole bunch of terms. And the terms look very much like what we had for Taylor series. If you take a derivative with respect to x m times, then you have to divide by m factorial. If you take a derivative with respect to y n times, you divide by n factorial. So those give you the coefficients. And if you want to write out the first few terms, you say f of x y, well, that's the point that you started with, plus C10. C10 is just the partial of f with respect to x divided by 1 factorial, times that times x minus a, plus partial with respect to y times y minus b. And then you get some more terms. You know, fxy gives you a cross term. There is an interaction between changes in x and changes in y, and fxy measures how big that is. Then you get an fxx term. This is the term that you would have had in your Taylor series anyway, if you just had a function of x. This is a term you would have had in your Taylor series anyway, if you just had a function of y. You put them all together, you keep going, and that's Taylor's theorem for functions of two variables. If you had a function of three variables, it's pretty similar. I'm not going to write it down. That's a bridge too far.